Okay, we're getting ready here, if you can take your seats. And welcome to the Planning Commission for December 2nd, 2015. Could I get a roll call?
Chairman Joshua Ayler.
Here.
Vice Chairman Christopher Sipple.
Present.
Commissioner David Blazer.
Here.
Commissioner Carl Bloomfield.
Here.
Commissioner David Cavanaugh.
Here.
Commissioner Brent Muti.
Here.
Commissioner Jennifer Whitman.
Here.
Alternate Brett Young.
Here.
Right here. Can I get approval of the agenda? A motion?
Your Honor?
Yes.
I move to approve the agenda as presented.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion by Vice Chair Sipple and a second by Commissioner Whitman. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Passes 7-0. So it brings us to item number 6, which is communications from citizens. At this time, members of the public may comment on matters not on the agenda. The commission's response is limited to responding to criticism, asking staff to review a matter commented upon, or asking that a matter be put on a future agenda. Is anybody here that likes to speak in this manner? Seeing none, we'll move forward. That brings us to the consent agenda. The public hearing consent agenda items will be heard in one public hearing. After the consent public hearing, these items may be approved by a single motion. At the request of a member of the commission or staff, an item may be removed from the consent calendar and may be heard and acted upon separately. Other items on the agenda may be added to the consent public hearing and approved under one single motion. Our consent agenda this month is UP15-12, and it's and GP14-01. Oh wait, I'm sorry. They're not. Are they the same? No, they are not. I'm sorry. So items UP15-12 is flats at Santan, which is being requested for continuance to January 6. And then GP14-01 is request for minor general plan amendment, which is also being requested to be continued to January 6. And Z14-01, which is also being asked to be continued to January 6. Then there's GP15-10, Cooley Station Parcel 17, and the minor general plan amendment. And then Z15-19, which is a request with Cooley Station. And item number 12, which is S15-13, which is Cooley Station's parcels 9, 11, and 17A. And then finally, item number 13, which is Z15-17, is Copperleaf Development. Do I have a motion for the consent agenda?
Your Honor. Your Honor.
Yes.
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion by Vice Chair Sipple and a second from Commissioner Blazer. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Passes 7-0. We have no items on our non-consent agenda, so that will move us directly to administrative items. This is, we'll be talking about G14-01 and Z14-01, but we won't be making any motions. We'll just discussion. So is the app, well, Amy Timms.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of Planning Commission. Just to give you a really brief overview of what is going to be discussed tonight. This is a little bit out of the ordinary. We had already noticed this project when it was decided, and the applicant requested a little bit of time to sort of do more of a study session format, but where he could show you some of the research that he had done and market studies. And since it had already been noticed, we decided the best way to do it was an administrative item. So we will be talking about a site that is up by Power and Ray Roads. It is a 41.3 acre site. And it is currently, and I'm just going to give you some basic facts about it, and then I'll let the applicant go ahead and speak. It is general planned as light industrial, all 41.3 acres. It is in the Power Road growth area per the general plan. It is an upcoming CIP for the front of the project, ST-128, which is the widening of Ray Road from Val Vista to Power. And a signal will be installed at Wren Road or Blue Jay Road when it is warranted. This parcel is in the Gateway Airport's day-night noise levels of 60 to 65, which is Zone 2. And it is considered a moderate noise category. The parcel is within the Gateway Character Area for neo-traditional design, and it is centered around the Gateway Town Center. It is zoned Business Park, 4.7 acres, and Light Industrial, 36.6 acres. So the applicant has requested to go ahead and make this presentation. This is for discussion only, and the item will be heard on January 6, 2016, per noticing requirements. Thank you.
Thank you, Amy. Is the applicant.
Good evening, and thank you for having us here. It's a pleasure to be in front of our Planning Commission. I just feel so good to know about all the volunteer service and all the hours that you're doing, and I have a little bit of experience, and it just reminds me of what it takes, and we really do appreciate all that you've done. My name is Ben Cooper. I work with Rose Law Group, and here helping to represent with the Circle G Holdings. Also, you'll be hearing a little bit from Greg Davis of iPlan Consulting, and then at the tail end of it, you'll have an opportunity to hear from Jason Barney of Circle G. Again, do appreciate your service. As I was kind of thinking about this night and actually standing on this side of a podium, it was kind of a odd feeling for me as I look back on my experience and that kind of thing. It goes back about 20 years as it relates to economic development, where I first worked with the Greater Phoenix Economic Council, attracting businesses to the Phoenix area. I worked there for 6 years or so, then went into private consulting practice, working with developers and builders. While I did that, I was a member and chair of our Gilbert Economic Development Advisory Board, and helped to craft the general plan, specifically the chapter on economic development. I chaired that subcommittee as well. And it's kind of fun to be here talking about economic development with you. And that's kind of where I'd like to focus my remarks is how this project really is an economic development project. And as we talk about economic development, one of the things that I've learned and you've probably learned is that economic development really is a game of site elimination. Consultants that work in this field are loaded with sites that overwhelm them at times, and their main goal is to find problems with every site that they can and get it off the list so they can whittle that list down for the final decision maker when they're trying to locate a place for an employer. And clearly, you might have workforce and some of the other things that are important, but if you don't have available sites that have the infrastructure right to your site, you're not development ready, and your name is taken right off the list, and they move on to the next one. So that's part of what we're trying to rectify here as we talk about this project. The location, as Amy mentioned, we're really grateful to the staff for allowing us to be here and for working with us over the probably the year and a half. I think some of you may have even seen this case a year and a half or so ago, and so this will sound a little bit familiar to you, but we appreciate the staff for working with us so well on it. It's a key location in Gilbert. As you know, it's right by the 202, it's right by Power Road, it's right by ASU Polytechnic and the airport, and those, because of that, it's an important corner or important area in town, and it definitely deserves the kind of discussion that it's received. Almost 20 years ago in the late 90s, Circle G Development, which you know, you've seen their product and the things that they've done for the community of Gilbert, is very impressive. And in this case, they went out to an area and pioneered yet another part of Gilbert. This was farmland, no infrastructure, barely any roads, And what they did is they basically created a success story by using market forces to pull infrastructure out to this area. So back then, home building was just crazy. Gilbert was the fastest community and growing community in the country, and they took advantage of that growth pressure and excitement to get some home builders out into this area, and those home builders, along with Circle G, pulled the infrastructure 8 miles into this area. And so it was a great example of how when infrastructure's there, you can have development, and as they work together, and you're leveraging those market forces. What has resulted, and this was, you know, 600 acres or so, what has resulted is a nice set of complementary land uses. Single family homes that started it, retail power centers, you know, Super Target, Super Walmart, and all the other users that are in that area. It's very successful. Vestar Center here in Gilbert, and as one of our crown jewels, if you will, from a revenue generating standpoint. Also, Gilbert Hospital and some other medical and flex uses have located here, so there's some employment that has started. Circle G has set aside and aggressively targeted users for large corporate offices, as well as small and medium-sized flex and industrial buildings. So they've worked really hard to round out this section. But probably what nobody could have realized or envisioned when this project first started out was the demand that people, residents, employees would have to live in high-end rental communities as well. Single family homes are wonderful for many people, but there are a lot of empty nesters, a lot of millennials, and others that want a different lifestyle than having that single family home. And so that wasn't originally included, but that is part of what we're talking about today, how that might round out this complementary land use situation and bring synergies to the area to support the economic development that we're all trying to achieve here. And as you think about economic development, the town's goal is to attract 10,000 jobs over 5 years. And it makes no sense to have a goal like that if you don't have the sites and the properties available to land those employers. And that's part of what we're trying to do here. Now again, so Circle G, obviously great vision for the area. They're actively marketing this zone. They've been involved in all of the major, any major user that's looking at the area, they've submitted on. They're working very hard, and they've received pretty positive feedback overall about the area, but they are receiving market feedback, and it's pretty clear that there are some issues with the site that we want to talk through a little bit about here tonight. First of all, just to orient you, we're looking at the parcel in question is the Circle G, 40 acres-ish. And we're going to say ish because I just rounded it to 40 acres when I put this slide together. You have the actual acreage. The Cowley family owns 29 acres, separate ownership and separate group. We're representing Circle G here tonight. And this property is right behind that Super Target there that is just west of the corner of Power and Ray Roads. So that kind of orients you where you're at. You can see that it's farmland. And Ray Road, it's kind of tough to tell there, but the frontage of Ray Road is only partially improved. There's only one lane that gets by in the westbound direction, and there is no real infrastructure inside the site, as you can see. And the Cowley family has really no marketable access at all. So while they're also hoping for employment uses, there's no way to get anybody back to them. And so they've been very supportive of us coming here and talking with you tonight. As we look at the regional context, there really is a significant competition, and some of it, as Gilbert residents, we're all very happy and proud of. If you look to the western part of Gilbert, you know, obviously the Chandler Airport is doing well, and you see all the buildings that are going up around that, but we're obviously proud of Rivulon at Gilbert and the 202, which is a project that the town partnered on in an incentive arrangement to try to get that project moving ahead of when it normally would develop. And we're seeing results there, and excited about that. You're well acquainted with the Santan Corridor. And then as you look out to the east, ASU Polytechnic, Phoenix Mesa Gateway, there's 700 to 1,000 acres of employment land there that they're marketing and working on. And then as you travel along the freeway, the 202 right at Hawes, kind of near the entrance to the what will someday be the passenger side of the airport. If you look over there, Via West just announced a big project that they're going to do. It's huge. And they're targeting employment uses as well as the multifamily residential, and really trying to leverage off of the next big player that we want to talk about, the really the prime competition for Gilbert. And if you talk to Dan Henderson in economic development, he'll back us up on that. But the prime competition in Gilbert is going to be the Eastmark development, which is in Mesa and has a lot going for it. Specifically, DMB Associates, great developer, wonderful, very deep pockets, very aggressive in their marketing, and able to do some things that other landowners aren't able to do. Obviously, when Apple came in the first time, the state and the city of Mesa and the utilities all went head over heels for them, as they should. I think it's great that we have Apple here, but they heavily subsidized the infrastructure into that area. And so that puts the price point now for properties in that area lower than it might be otherwise, because the infrastructure was pulled in there at government expense in some cases. And so you've got that, and obviously Apple, with its gravitational pull, makes it a very compelling case for many employers want to locate out there, because the prices anyone else can get are undercut by DMB, and it's a huge competitor. So Gilbert, we need to have our eyes open as it relates to economic development. We need to understand what's around us. Circle G, like I mentioned, there's some great strengths for the site, but really the key is if it were development ready, and that's what we want to talk through a little bit about. The chicken and the egg that we've talked about. You can't get the infrastructure in there if you don't have the users, because you can't finance it. You can't take it to a bank and say, can we just go ahead and finance, in this case, over $3 million worth of infrastructure, and then, you know, hopefully we'll get a user. You can't do that, but at the same time, you can't get the users if you don't have the infrastructure. So we're stuck in kind of a tough cycle that is very difficult to break without some assistance. And so that makes it difficult to compete today. And as you look at the overall site, I think I probably glossed over the fact that there is so much employment land still set aside over there. I think it's 130 acres in that area. If we were to take 20 acres and to put it into another use that would be supportive of residential or of employment uses, if you take that 20 acres out, you still have a lot of land that is now development ready and able to be pursued. And so we are hopeful that, like Circle G did in the late 90s, we can leverage development, the momentum that there is in certain development sectors, to bring infrastructure into this area and light it up, if you will, for employers that are looking for a place here in Gilbert, because of the site is so good for that. So as we look at this again, without the infrastructure, we got 69 acres that are offline, and probably wait another cycle or two or three or whatever and get passed over while everyone goes and enjoys the gravity of Apple and Eastmark. Or, you know, if we work together on something here, we feel like we can really strengthen Gilbert's hand as it relates to economic development. And that's kind of the reasoning for this ask and for this change in land use is, again, it really is to help accelerate economic development in this area. So that's kind of the why. I'm going to turn it over to Greg Davis now to talk about the how.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, Greg Davis with iPlan Consulting. I want to thank Ben for that presentation. He handles that why aspect a lot better than I do. I'm a land planner by trade, and I'm here to talk about more of the land use side of why we're proposing it here. Obviously, the objective is to accelerate and enable this project for development, and we are doing that through land use change from a general plan perspective as well as a zoning perspective. I would like to first talk about how we see employment and economic development, because as we've looked at this case over the past couple years, there's been a lot of discussion about, are they at odds or should they be at odds? A lot of people, when they think of multifamily, they think of an apartment project that maybe doesn't have any benefit at all to an employment area. And that's just simply not the case. And so we've done a study, which this slide represents a few quotes out of, but it's also been discussed, for instance, at the Mayor's Ambassador Forum earlier this year, that there is actually a very strong symbiotic relationship between employment and multifamily projects, and that together, not only can they survive, but they can actually thrive. And here are some quotes from that Ambassador Forum meeting. And the best way, I think, to show this is to actually give you a live example, something that we've looked at quite closely, and probably most everyone in this room is familiar with. And that's our neighbor Chandler's Price Road corridor right off of the 202 and Chandler. And so you can see on this photograph on the slide that every red dot is an apartment project. Now, this is seen as one of the most highly prized employment corridors, I think, in at least the East Valley, if not the whole Phoenix region. And it's simply to show that not only is there a relationship between multifamily, can they coexist with these employment uses, but there may be a reason why this is so successful that has to do with those uses put together. And so when we look at a closer example, which is further south on that corridor, this slide is of the Chandler Innovation Zone. This was actually a project that was partnered on by the City of Chandler and the landowners that I think is very analogous to what we're proposing out at Power and Ray. You have a large campus, employment campus that the city would like to see developed. You also have a lot of existing land uses, which include single-family residential. And one of the things that Chandler has purposely put into this is a multifamily component, which was actually built by Mark Taylor, I believe. And you can see that right off of Germain Road. It's very similar to our proposal because we're proposing it off of Germain or off of Ray Road, further away from the main corridor, which in this case is Price Road. In our case, it's Power Road. Now, one of the things I want to touch on real briefly is the point of how much multifamily is too much. Very highly debated topic in Gilbert throughout the years. This is a slide that we've put together just to show that we feel that Gilbert is substantially below other communities as far as a pro rata of multifamily housing units. And when we think about the most successful communities from a full sustainability, not just employment or residential, we think of Scottsdale and Chandler and Tempe, et cetera. Those projects, each of those, are over double what Gilbert has. So we feel that, you know, just on a principle alone, Gilbert should have more multifamily housing, and that's what this slide represents. The question is, where do we put it? That's always the question. This slide shows the general plan of the town. We've kind of manipulated the colors to highlight the multifamily, which is shown in red. So you can see throughout the town, we have several employment corridors, and each of them has a component of multifamily. The area that we're in question about here, yeah, this slide works, which is where our site is located, really doesn't have that existing component. Now, there are sites within 1 or 2 miles, but I think you'll see that those specific sites are really geared towards a different type of multifamily housing. And Ben touched on the housing shift that we're seeing, which has really created kind of a diversification of multifamily. Historically, when we think of multifamily, we think of more of the affordably driven apartment projects that people live in because they can't afford to live in a house. And that is one aspect of multifamily, but it is just one aspect of it. We also have the college off-campus related housing that not only do we see in Tempe, we actually expect to see that in a lot of those red areas that I showed around the village center on Cooley Station. So although there is multifamily opportunities in the area, we think that they're definitely geared to a different type of lifestyle. Other types of multifamily that we're starting to see are the urban loft lifestyles that we see in downtown areas. Downtown Gilbert would be a great example of where people would want to live because it's close to restaurants, close to theaters, etc. But the last one is one we want to talk about because it's one that we feel is the most appropriate here, and it's actually part of our proposal, and that's kind of the luxury resort lifestyle that Mark Taylor has done so well, and that's why we specifically partnered up with them. We think that type of multifamily project is the most compatible with the single-family development that we have surrounding our site. And the reasons for that are identified in the slide. But basically, it's a lifestyle choice product. So the people that are living there are choosing to live there for the amenities, for the lifestyle, et cetera. And that's going to generate higher rents that are going to be more similar to what the homes in the areas are renting for, making it more compatible with that project. And the last bullet point I want to talk about just a bit is something that we've heard from employers looking to locate in areas that don't have multifamily. There's a lot of need for companies when they come in and hire employees that need some sort of temporary housing that's nearby. When myself and my wife moved here, we could have afforded the house, but we didn't know where we wanted to live. So we ended up renting for 2 years before we figured out we wanted to live in Gilbert, and that's where we bought a house. But you're going to see that example in this area. With all this acreage of employment, you're going to get a lot of people that want to find something that's close and nearby that has a high quality lifestyle component to it. And we think that this adds that element that doesn't exist today. Now, we chose this site for several reasons. One is, pure land use transition. We have residential on two sides of this site. To the west and to the south. And so from a land use planning standpoint, we typically want to take that lower intensity use and protect it from the higher intensity uses. And that's what this slide represents. The multifamily kind of acts as a buffer transition to the more medium intensity uses of the employment, as also the retail, commercial, and freeway uses, which are shown in red. And we've also feel that this site were to develop as employment would be probably the least friendly employment site that we have because of its adjacency to residential developments. And it's also the furthest from what we believe is the view corridor and the accessibility corridor for the site. Ray Road is a major arterial as far as a transportation classification, but it acts as really a minor arterial when it comes to an employment corridor. And so this site is probably the least accessible and visible for that area. From a neighborhood aspect, we've had a couple neighborhood meetings and several ongoing discussions with some of the neighbors, and we actually have quite a bit of support for this proposal. One of the main reasons is the transportation element that Ben pointed out is not very good in this area. Wren Drive, which is located right here, kind of serves as a secondary entrance for that whole neighborhood. And right now, there's no signalization or anything at that location. So getting out onto Ray Road is very difficult at times. So one of their primary concerns and benefits that they see about this project is the fact that we're going to have improved Ray Road, we're going to have improved Wren Road, we're going to have improved Circulation Road that actually bring them over to a signal at the Blue Jay Drive alignment. So they see that as a big improvement. They're also very concerned about this Wren Drive because it really acts as a front door for half of that community. And they're really concerned about if it develops an employment, what is that going to look like? Are we going to get long linear buildings that really don't have any character and friends come over there, it's not going to be a welcoming site. So this proposal is something they support because it brings in more of a residential character to their front door. And it brings in also residential architecture, different massing, so that when you're driving up and down the street, it feels like an entrance to a residential area more so than it does in employment. And the last comment that they've made to us is that many of them are familiar with Mark Taylor Communities, and they really feel that that would actually be an improvement from a rental standpoint over many of the rental situations that are in the neighborhood already. So we feel we have really good support from the neighbors, which is fairly rare in this type of situation. So in the end, what we're trying to produce is sustainable and viable land plan, not just for our 20 acres or our 40 acres, but for really for this whole area. We have a lot of existing uses, we have a lot of existing activity, but there's also a lot of available land that we want to fill in, and we feel that this component helps make the whole area more sustainable in the long term. So this slide is basically the conclusion, kind of talks about what we're hoping to get out of these proposed changes. The key element is obviously bringing in a high-quality multifamily developer that's going to help us bring the infrastructure for Ray Road, Wren Drive, as well as the utilities. It's going to open up the back Cowley parcel, which currently, you know, couldn't be developed without more access, even though it has that excellent freeway visibility. Ben touched on this a little bit with Eastmark. There's going to be a significant pressure put on the retail centers at Ray and Power Road because of what's happened in the Eastmark and further in Mesa. This project will bring 300 or so families that will help support the existing retail restaurants and stores that exist today that may have a challenge surviving in the future. We've shown, hopefully, that, you know, by providing this multifamily, we're providing a better land use transition, and we're actually protecting what the neighbors see as, you know, their quality of life and their lifestyle through a more similar land use in their mind. And there is a financial benefit for the town, you know, over a 30-year period that is significant that Jason can talk to if he so chooses to. But the main reason we're here is because we're really trying to promote not only the ability to develop the employment part of this property and the adjacent properties, but we're trying to accelerate that development so it happens sooner. And so with that, I would invite Jason to come up and impose any parting comments. Thank you.
My name is Jason Barney. I'm with Circle G. I'm one of the property owners and the developer on this. And just some quick wrap-up comments. Next year marks 40 years of Circle G building stuff in Gilbert. And we've built everything from the big custom home neighborhoods to shopping centers to office buildings to warehouses to, you know, we've kind of covered the gamut here. In fact, we built one of the very first employment centers in the town of Gilbert, Fiesta Tech Center, up on Baseline and Country Club, if you're familiar with that. So we've been here a long time, and we have a lot of history and experience in what it takes to leverage development to create more development opportunities. Ben talked through how this entire area is there because we leverage single-family residential development to bring the sewer out and bring the shopping centers and the office building that we built out there. And I share that with you because I want you to know that with Circle G, you know, we've been in Gilbert for a long time. We've been on this particular site for 15 years. We'll probably be on this site for another 10 or 15 years before we're done with it. We've still got another 100 or so acres left to go to develop out office buildings and flex buildings and different things we want to do out there. So we bring to the table a significant amount of commitment to Gilbert, vision for what we want to have happen out here, half of which is already executed, half of which we have left to execute. And this is an opportunity for us to leverage development to make future development opportunities happen. The bottom line is this: there's 69 acres on the north side of Ray Road right now that really just functionally can't be developed, can't be marketed, because we are lacking $3 million worth of infrastructure. That there is no business case that we can make to either ourselves or to a bank to go speculatively build out that $3 million of infrastructure. By doing this project and including a multifamily element to it, we're able to bring that 69 acres from being basically in mothballs to legitimately and competitively to the market. And that's really what we're trying to do. This is not some kind of fly-by-night, make-a-quick-buck kind of company out here trying to do what's quick and easy. This is Circle G, who's been here a long time, going to be here a long time, and wants to make something happen. So I know a lot of the discussion has been focused on sort of the multifamily element of this. But it's very important to understand that of this particular proposal, it's actually a 40-acre proposal, of which only half is multifamily. The other half is a combination of flex buildings and office buildings and warehouses. In addition to that, what's not included in our proposal is the 29 acres of Cali family property that will now be able to be marketed as a result of what we're doing. So we'd love to have you take a positive consideration of what we're trying to do, leverage this project to create more opportunity, and we'd be happy to take any questions.
Great, thank you. It was very detailed. Do we have any questions for the applicant or comments at this time? Okay. Okay. All right, go ahead.
Jason and team, thank you. That was a great presentation. And and just exactly the kind of flavor of Kool-Aid that I like to drink. So I'm drinking it. I appreciate the presentation, and I'm in full support of that. I think it's a great plan, well thought out, well conceived, and I would be in support of something like you're proposing. I think it's a great thing.
Commissioner Blazer?
Just curious, how does the tax revenue for a town, tax revenue of multifamily versus industrial play out?
I do have a slide for that. We did do a study, Applied Economics did it, based on the rental sales tax that comes from this, as well as the incremental shopping that happens at the neighboring retail over a 30-year span of time, is about $3.5 million net positive benefit to the town compared to the existing land use.
Okay, great. I like the project. I'm excited that it would accelerate development out there, and I think a lot of good things can come from it.
Commissioner Cavaney.
So, thank you, guys. Well done. You know what? I heard this case a year and a half or so ago, and I remember at the time, and this is just maybe to share with everyone else on the commission who may not have been here at that time, the concern that was expressed at the time was that at least for me, my focus was on the residential to the west and the impact that they would feel from moving from, I think it was light industrial to multifamily. And we were concerned that the buildings could go higher, that they could look into their yards, that they would be, that there would be some concerns with that use. So to hear that first of all, you're going with a high-end and multifamily developer, and I'm familiar with Mark Taylor. They do a great product. They really do a great product. And so I think that's a real good step in the right direction of getting the right component if you're going to do multifamily. And also to find out that the neighbors have expressed interest, and I'd love to know more about that during regular session when you come, as to some of their comments, because it emboldens me to understand that they prefer multifamily in a quality product instead of light industrial. So I think the dynamics have changed from the last time we heard this, in that you've brought forth a quality developer, you brought forth a neighborhood support, which I think were two things I didn't see last time that I definitely see now, and I do think that this does bring some energy to that Cowley property, which I do agree is challenged back there against the freeway without access. So I think you're really headed in the right direction. I think you'll see some favorable feedback in regular session as you continue to develop some of these points that you've talked about. So,
yeah. Great, thanks. Commissioner Whitman?
So I'm going to go off the deep end. I'm struggling with this case, as I've mentioned to the applicants. One, because I have no issue with multifamily. I think everybody knows that. It's not a use issue for me. It's a location issue for me. And at this point in time, I don't see the justification in giving up the industrial at this location for multifamily. And we have to remember, too, that when we're zoning for use, not for user. And so although they're touting Mark Taylor, and Mark Taylor may not come through, and I mean, there's lots of things that can happen. So what we really have to look at is multifamily the correct and right use and appropriate use for this particular property? And I'm not so certain that, in my opinion, that it is necessarily the best use, and I also don't like the feeling that it's being a negotiating point that if we throw in the multifamily, then I get this infrastructure, and then I can build the industrial. Well, industrial happens every day. Residential happens every day. You just have to have the right users who want the site badly enough, and they'll throw the money at it. But I have a difficult time trying to see that the multifamily is the justification for getting the money in the door for this particular site. I need to look at it as a land use issue and a land use basis at this particular location, and is this the right land use long term for this property? There's a lot of vacant, available and ready light industrial in the area, in particular on the south side of Ray Road, behind the Walmart, which I think they own, and a lot of that is available. There's not that I want anything going to Mesa, but there's a lot on the east side of Power. So I don't know if if at this point, for me, if multifamily is the right land use at this location, and especially if it's simply the stepping stone for trying to get in industrial surrounding the site. And I'm really concerned that if we're simply just zoning for the multifamily and we're not really touching the light industrial, we're not really creating a sort of overall development plan for this area, that it's going to be pretty easy for them or somebody to come back with an expansion for multifamily that frequently happens. Oh, well, this site isn't going to be, this site isn't any good anymore. The light industrial users don't want, you know, this small of a site. They wanted a bigger site. And so therefore, and we've seen that happen multiple times. And so these are all the things that, and I'm just spouting because this is what I do, the things that are going through my head about, is this the right location for multifamily, and is this the right boost to get this site developed? And especially when Cali, the property to the north, adjacent to the freeway, isn't part of this overall development plan. They're just kind of sitting there waiting, I think, to see how this turns out. So because of all of those concerns that I have, I'm not quite convinced at this point that multifamily is the best use at this location.
Thank you. Commissioner Cavaney.
So the Commissioner, the one thing that helped me on this is because I was very concerned with the same thing at the last presentation, is that buffer between single family and power center or regional commercial. I wasn't sure that multifamily was the right mix. I didn't feel the homeowners would want that use. But given all the employment in that area and the need to support that employment with labor and employment and people, and knowing that the residents really do prefer that, I my approach was a little softened. I don't know if that helps at all, but I mean, we're looking for something to appropriately buffer single family to the power center, and I mean, yeah, we would give up some light industrial, that is fair, and I think we found a user that wants this, and I think that's a reasonable use for a buffer. At least that's what helped me get over this, because I had the same concern. So, yeah.
And speaking to the buffer issue, I don't necessarily think that it's necessary. There's a street that buffers and separates those two uses. And also, if you look at the industrial uses that are already planned and approved on the south side of Ray Road, those are immediately adjacent to residential, also with a similar situation of just a separation, a road in between. So there's the same circumstance, but there isn't the multifamily to buffer them. And I think it's going to work just fine. So I don't know that's enough for me.
Okay. Well, I guess I'm glad I sit between the two of you, because I'm right in the middle between both of you guys in my ideology. I guess I do like that the residential buffer between the two, having light industrial, you have more heavy trucks, and it's a different kind of flow of traffic that abuts right next to single family. I do have a little worry of losing the light industrial, so I'd still like to see a little more reason for that portion. And then I think I saw in somewhere that I'd like to see the multifamily in the area in a radius area, kind of so we can see what's in different areas, you know, within a mile, 3 miles, or I guess our staff might have a copy of something like that. Ms. Thames is coming up behind you. So that's multifamily, the dots?
Correct. What you see there is, if it's green, it's existing multifamily that's constructed and occupied. If it's the purple, it's under development. And if it's blue, it's vacant. And they're just numbered so you can identify them a little easier. But and you can see the radius is 1 mile and 2 mile. And then the red line is the gateway character area.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Blazer.
Can you point out which are vacant and which aren't? I can't tell the color difference.
Certainly, it does not show real well on the screen. So let me help you here. Number one is occupied. Number 13 is occupied. number 6 is occupied, and then we have 14, 18, and 16 occupied. And then if you'd like the ones that are under development, meaning either in construction documents, design review process, or actually pulling a permit, that would be 7, 5, 17, and 15. And the rest of the blue dots are all vacant. That was it, mostly those.
Okay, thank you.
Certainly.
I guess, well, I'd like, go ahead, yeah. Commissioner Muni.
Can you clarify what they mean by vacant with the multifamily? Okay. Like,
is that vacant land? Oh.
Nothing on it.
Yeah, just vacant land.
Raw land available and with the proper zoning. Now, also just mindful that this red area right in here is the Gateway Village Center, which is allowed for mixed-use development, and you can have loft above in those areas. But this was, I was just looking at multifamily zoning, not SFA, not SFD, just multifamily, MFL or MF.
Commissioner Blazer.
I think based on that, we need some multifamily in that area. I think that supports, in my opinion, it supports the need for multifamily, especially if we're going to have employment centers with light industrial around there.
Chair Oler, if I could.
Yeah, go ahead.
Site number 12 is actually owned by two of my partners, and they've been out actively marketing that site for quite a long time. And everybody they've talked to currently at this time in the market doesn't have an interest in that site. The primary reason for that is because the site we're talking about up here is closer to the freeway, closer to the amenities, closer to the shopping, closer to the restaurants. Now eventually the Cooley Station corridor up there is going to see more interest, but the thing to kind of take away from that is what you're looking at with these sites over here is it's a different submarket, and ultimately it's going to be a different product type that's going to go there. And so while they definitely interrelate in terms of being a mile apart on one level, at the other level, this is really a kind of a different submarket here with different product type, and it's kind of a little bit apples and oranges.
Your Honor. Thank you. Commissioner, Vice Chair Sipple.
I would also say that plays out for the multifamily. We don't know what Mesa has on the other side of the road, right? We're just seeing Gilbert. So while it may, when you look at it at face value here, it may be, oh, yeah, we need something right there. Well, I don't know that I necessarily know what's on the other side of the road there, or what's going to be developed in there, or what changes may be coming to that municipality. So I'm not sure that I am in complete agreement with that thought process as far as that site needing it.
Well, I mean, if we could expand on something like this.
Yeah, we sure can.
That picks up the radiuses going into Mesa and maybe a little more description. I know this isn't yours, but more. And if staff could do the same or somewhere work together on that. And then I guess some clarification, just so I understand the infrastructure, the $3 million, that would be to build out all the way around the site and Ray Road.
Finish out Ray Road, build Blue Jay, build Orchid, half of Orchid, and finish out Wren, yes.
Of the entire frontage?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to see some more information on if we're giving up the light industrial. I'd like to see some more. We see the information that's been given of what's needed for the multifamily, and then I guess, but we're giving up light industrial. Is there a greater need? I know we're looking at the point is that we're bringing the $3 million to activate part of it, or half, well, 20 acres or so, so we can get shovel ready kind of ideas. But I'd like to see other light industrial in here and can some data points on, I mean, do we greatly need that and way more than do we need multifamily, or do we not really need that point at this point in time? And then kind of, I know we're here for the town of Gilbert, but I'd also like to see kind of,
so
like what's going is such a border site to Mesa Gateway, and which is a critical point. I like, you know, kind of feed into the Mesa data if we can see some of that side of it too. So, Commissioner Muti.
I've been listening and absorbing a lot, and I've been bouncing back and forth as I've heard the various arguments. To build on what you were just saying, I'd like to see something similar for this if we could with industrial, to see what's vacant, what's existing, and understand the demand and supply there as we talk about potentially giving up some light industrial. This was begins to become a very compelling exhibit in front of us. Fundamentally, I didn't have a challenge with multifamily being adjacent to the single family as the buffer. In principle, I'm probably a little more challenged with the approach. Yeah, it feels more like a stick and a carrot than it does chicken and the egg. You know, give us the multifamily and you'll get the industrial. But beyond the principle of that, the land use, I don't struggle with it.
Okay. Any other questions, comments? I think we've had some good discussion. Do you have any more to add?
One closing comment, and thank you for the feedback. It's very helpful. We'll go work on some of those ideas. I'll just say that where we're sitting right now, it's really more like a 130-acre employment corridor that we've basically built out and will continue to build out. We've already built a 36,000-square-foot industrial building in this corridor and have tenants in that space. So we do have a really, really good feel for what the market is. We've got probably a couple 100,000 more square feet of office building, flex building, industrial building that we're going to build out here. And to a concern that Commissioner Whitman had, this proposal is not just for 20 acres of multifamily. It's actually 40 acres, of which half is multifamily, and the other half is a variety of employment uses that we plan to bring. It's not intended to be a carrot and stick kind of thing. It's just more of a reality. We're out there every day trying to market this, and this is the challenge that we're running up against. And the Cali family is even at a more significant detriment than we are, because they can't do anything until something happens with this property. So we'll come back with a lot more of the information that you're talking about, but I think the way we see this is it's a minimal 20-acre downside, of which is not really a downside because you got some transition and things going on, with a significant upside to bring in 69 acres online. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have a few other administrative items. We have our review of 2015. Linda Edwards.
Good evening, Chairman and Commissioners. Just a brief thank you. It's our opportunity to really look at the work that you've done over the past year, and in your staff report you can see that there are some significant projects in there, from the northern boundary baseline city gate at Higley and Baseline. We have two congregate care facilities that have been approved, and you also have been involved in looking at that project through preliminary plat. And that type, wouldn't you know, I just lost my page. I'll just go by memory. Through your work over the years, you have not only updated the Santan character area, the general plan, which is one of your major roles in our community, you have also reviewed recently Somerset, which is a significant project in our community, about 110 acres, I believe, something of that nature, that surrounds the temple at Pecos in Greenfield, a wonderful project with a range of product types, and your review of that was detailed. You're continuing to review projects in that area. You have also reviewed several use permits, preliminary plats, updated the land development code with text amendments for new things coming to our community. You've been involved on subcommittees. Our chairman is involved in the land use compatibility study that the Phoenix Mesa Gateway Airport, you know, devoting his time and expertise to that project. The Commissioner Cavaney was working with us this evening with some applicants who needed that level of expertise in his industry, along with our chairman. Also very thankful for that. I guess to make it personal, I really do see how much each one of you has really been vocal and giving of your time and working with each other from your area, from your professional experience. Gilbert is very, and including Brett, I'm looking up here, but I'm including you, is very thankful for the level of expertise that our residents are gaining. We are recognized nationally for some of this success, what some of the recognition that we have, which is on our website if you're interested in the whole list, but I only just pulled out a few. 22nd best place to live, 20th best city to live in America, second safest city, third best city to find a job, 16th best city for first-time home buyers. So I only get to say it once a month, but our residents thank you every day. And it's just a pleasure to work with you and to have you volunteer and provide your expertise. So thank you very much, and Merry Christmas to everyone.
Thank you. I appreciate you bringing this to us. We get to see this every year or so, but it brings us back in time and looking at some of these cases, and I'm like, oh, well, that was just, and the cell towers are all being built right now, and I've seen some kind of like, okay, that one worked well, that one, all right, well, but that was back in August, so it's nice to see some of the stuff and hashing back some of what we've gone over the years, so thank you again. That brings us to the minute to approval or study session of and regular meeting of November 4th. Do I have a motion, or anybody have anything to add with the minutes from last month?
Normally I would approve, but I was not in attendance.
So how would you know?
Will not.
So do I have a motion from someone?
Chairman, I move to approve the minutes.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion for approval of the minutes of November 4th, 2015 by Commissioner Whitman, a second by Commissioner Cavaney. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And so that brings us to communications. Report from Chairman and Commissioners. As Linda mentioned, on the subcommittee for the Planning Advisory Committee for the Phoenix Mesa Gateway Airport. It's been a lot of good discussion, a lot of interesting things that will affect us as a town. And one interesting component was that the capacity of the airport would be 498,000 landings and takeoffs combined in 1 year as a capacity for Mesa Gateway, which is a mixture of different things that we hear and how it will go, but it'll show how much a viable piece that'll be to our community. And then a lot of good discussion on what restrictions we'll need as a town and not for sound levels. But does anybody else have anything to add?
I have something as well.
Vice Chair Sippel.
This Saturday, and usually our council liaison will share lots of things. She's very good at doing that for us. But this Saturday is Santan Village's Balloon Glow, which is an event that's a favorite of mine and our family. So they have, 15 or 20 hot air balloons that they do activities with. And last year they had sky jumpers, and it was just a fantastic family event. So it's great for Gilbert. It's a perfect time of the year. You can bundle up and see the balloons. So I would encourage everyone to come out Saturday night to Santan Village and participate in that.
Thank you. Commissioner Cavaney.
So I'm not sure if this is the right place to ask this or to propose this, but given for those who didn't know, the chairman and I were asked, and only me because of my experience in mixed use, to revisit a case tonight, or give some ideas, I should say. It wasn't really revisiting the case. So give us some ideas on how to do mixed use, and it was brought to our attention that maybe our language isn't sufficient. The language we developed recently for mixed use, that it may not be sufficient.
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Cavaney.
Mm-hmm.
It appears that what the commissioner is proposing would be a change to standards in the development code, and this is not an appropriate time on the agenda to do so, and we haven't publicized it as such. Well,
exactly. So I wanted to propose that we put that on a future agenda. That's all I'm asking. I didn't want to go too deep. I wanted them to understand why I was proposing that. Right.
So I apologize for jumping the gun.
No, that's fine. So I don't know if staff can take that back and say, hey, this is something we can put on a future agenda, maybe explore, whatever, but I think we ought to do that. That's my recommendation anyway. Thanks.
Any other comments that we want to add? Okay. That brings us to Councilor Liaison.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I wasn't here last month, and it feels like I haven't seen you for such a long time. Missing 1 month, throws me off somehow. But I'm glad to be here tonight with you and wanted to talk about a couple things that are current. You know that the census count is going on and should be completed on December 6th. That's our deadline date. If people have not been, had anyone come to their home yet, we ask them to call the U.S. Census Bureau at 480-503-6565, and they can take the survey over the telephone. But I think otherwise the census count has been going really well in the community. I haven't heard too many comments from citizens, so I think it's been going pretty smoothly. Tomorrow evening, December 3rd, to go along with some of the events that are going on in the area, will be dueling pianos at Water Tower Plaza. That's from 6:30 to 8:30. They come out, they actually bring pianos down there to the plaza, and you can bring chairs or blankets and come out and sit down there if you haven't been down. The Christmas lights were turned on a couple Wednesdays ago by the mayor, and it looks beautiful at night. The park's all lit up, so it's one thing going on. And I wanted to throw out that I haven't mentioned in a while is the Gilbert Farmers Market's going on every Saturday morning right down there off of Page from 8 to noon. They have lots of vendors, and of course they're open year-round, but I like to just tout them every once in a while so that you remember to go visit them. If you haven't been down there, you really need to take your kids, take your pets, just go enjoy the morning. There's food trucks, everything. The Gilbert Art Walk will also be this Saturday, December 5th. They run typically every other Saturday during the winter time, and they will be under the Water Tower Plaza from 9 to 1 on Saturday morning, so you can hit the Farmers Market and the Gilbert Art Walk at the same time. It's a great event. The town of Gilbert Fire and Rescue has a clothing and toys drive going on to benefit Gilbert boys and girls, and they're asking for clothes and toys, new clothes and toys, to be donated unwrapped to donation boxes that are located all over the community in all of the fire stations. Feel free to just stop by. The Banner Gateway Medical Center, Banner MD Anderson, and several other locations, and can all be found on the website. They will be collecting those through Monday, December 21st. So while you're out shopping, if you think of that and want to drop some of those things off. And I know, for instance, they look for some of the middle-aged kids, like 11 to 15, and they like gift cards for those kids because it's really hard to buy for them, but they're the ones that really need the gifts too. So that's a great thing. Now, earlier tonight, you heard the mention of the new trash pickups, and when we were talking on the staff call yesterday morning, even the chairman said that he hadn't heard about them. So starting on Monday, January 4th, there will be new trash recycling and bulk pickups. So there's a new schedule. There's a video, and I just went ahead and emailed all of you with all of that information. So you have a link to the website. It has all of the information, and I encourage you to go watch the video because, again, Gilbert Digital has done a really fun video to kind of get out the word to everybody that this is going on. You will be putting your black and blue can out at the same time. Your day of week has probably changed, so make sure you go out and check that out. And, again, it'll start on Monday, January 4th to start off the new year. So. And as Linda said, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and we'll see you back here in January.
Thank you for all that information. I'll be watching the video because I need to know. it brings us back to Linda, if you have any more.
I just have one more thank you. I'd like to thank our clerk, Margot, and our council member for always being so informative. And, of course, our attorney, Jack Vincent, and also the two gentlemen in the back there that do everything for us. Thank you so much. And then our principal planner, Catherine, she does a lot of behind the scenes at these meetings and coaches our planners. And just very thankful for our wonderful team that we have.
Great. Thank you. Well, that's the end of the session for this year. So Merry Christmas to everybody. Happy New Year. And meeting adjourned.